Good evening, everyone. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to the first Justice P.N. Gopati Memorial Lecture. Our esteemed guest for the evening is Mr. M.C. Mehta, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India. Mr. Mehta requires no introduction. He is an outstanding environmentalist who has made his life's mission to protect India's environment. He has pioneered legal activism for the environmental protection and is proof that one man can make a difference. Mr. Mehta hails from the Jammu and Kashmir and started his practice in the J&K High Court. He began his career in the Supreme Court of India in 1983 and since then has focused on environmental protection. Mr. Mehta is probably the only Supreme Court lawyer to have taken up legal battles with the polluting Indian industry and come out victorious. He tirelessly worked for 10 years to protect the Taj Mahal from corrosive pollution from the coal-based industries in the vicinity of the Taj. It was because of his persistence and dedication that ultimately the Supreme Court shut down more than 200 factories in the area and required about 300 others to install pollution control devices. Mr. Mehta has often been described as a one-man enviro-legal brigade and has been a recipient of several illustrious awards. To name a few, he was awarded the Goldman Environmental Prize, the United Nations Global 500 Award, and the prestigious Magsaysay Award for his contributions. It is my great privilege to welcome you, sir. Now I would like to invite Professor C. Rajkumar, Vice Chancellor, Jindal Global University, and Dean Jindal Global University to deliver the
A very good afternoon to all of you. It is indeed a very special day for us, and I am so delighted to see all of you just at the beginning of the four-day weekend to be able to join us on this very special occasion. We are today celebrating the extraordinary life of Honorable Mr. Justice P.N. Bhagwati, this first memorial lecture in recognition of Justice Bhagwati is being held today and is being delivered by Mr. M.C. Mehta, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India, and obviously one of the most outstanding and inspiring environmental thinkers of the world. Before we begin the formal part of this day's proceedings, I would request you to kindly stand up as we pay tribute to Professor, a very distinguished environmental activist, Professor G.D. Agarwal, who died recently, in many ways devoting his entire life to the cause of environment. Let us pay tribute by observing a minute of silence. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. As some of you know, Professor Agarwal was a very distinguished professor at IIT, also an alumnus of IIT Roorkee, but also University of California, Berkeley. A very distinguished professor and a researcher who pretty much devoted his life for the cause of environment, and he is no longer with us. There is obviously a very interesting connection between Mr. M.C. Mehta, Justice Bhagwati, and Professor Agarwal, about which Mr. Mehta will briefly mention as he delivers his lecture. I'll keep my remarks very short. All I want to say is that today we are also celebrating, as I said, Justice P.N. Bhagwati's contribution. I had the privilege of meeting two extraordinary individuals in the year 1994 when I was a student at the Faculty of Law at Delhi University. One was Justice P.N. Bhagwati, and another was Mr. M.C. Mehta, both of whom had visited the campus law center faculty of Law, Delhi University, upon my invitation as a young student, and had really inspired me in so many ways. Justice Bhagwati was obviously a very distinguished judge, but most importantly brought innovative thinking and creativity in interpretation of the Constitution, and expanded significantly human rights jurisprudence to include environment. For all the law students who are in the room, the jurisprudence that Justice Bhagwati and Mr. M.C. Mehta developed in many ways defined the field of environmental law, not just in India, but also in the entire Commonwealth and beyond. Of course, Justice Bhagwati, I had the privilege to be closely associated with his work all through my years at Oxford and Harvard, later in New York and Tokyo and Hong Kong, and during which time I had the privilege to discuss with him about the establishment of the university itself. And as early as 2008, Justice Bhagwati visited our Delhi office along with his wife, Mrs. Bhagwati, and blessed us in the evolution of this university. He was so closely associated with us, and we deeply miss him on today's occasion. I'm very delighted that his daughter, Mrs. Sonali Bhagwati, will be joining us today at this lecture. As far as Mr. Mehta is concerned, he does not need any introduction, but it is suffice to say that there are very few people in the world who have been deeply committed to a cause that is intrinsically confrontational to both state and non-state actors, and yet constantly endeavored to seek that transformation, that change through law. For those of us who study jurisprudence, we have studied the Pondian philosophy of law is an instrument of social engineering. Mr. Mehta led a life that deeply committed itself to seeking fundamental social transformation through instruments of law and courts. He also believes in the idea of the rule of law in a country in which laws are constantly violated, and he can only tell us that how does he maintain hope in an environment of hopelessness, in an environment in which all those fundamental values that we believe are constantly violated, how does one every day keep that hope, instill that hope, and live a life towards engaging with that hope and idea? So with those words, I have great pleasure in inviting Mr. M.C. Mehta to deliver the Justice P.N. Bhagwati first memorial lecture on the theme Environmental Activism, Expanding the Legal and Constitutional Boundaries for Promoting Environmental Justice. Thank you.
Respected Shri Rajkumar Ji, and the members of the faculty, as well as students of this university. First of all, I would like to thank Shri Rajkumar Ji for organizing such a meet, because it is to remember the continuity of the past to the present and to the future. The people, those who have done work in their lifetimes in the past, we should never forget. And we should remember that because they laid the foundation, and that foundation, over it, a building was constructed. The hopes, the first we think, then the hope is there to do something, and then after that we should think of the victory, or we should think of its fruit. Nothing can happen in vacuum. Justice Bhagwati's first, this memorial lecture, it is a privilege for me, in the sense that I joined practice in the Supreme Court of India in 1983. And in 1983, but at that time we were very junior lawyers. You know that in the Supreme Court is like a sea, eminent lawyers are there. You are never even recognized who is there and who is not there. But I filed a case. The first case which I filed, that was the Taj Mahal case on environment. And with great difficulty, I could obtain that notice in that case. That is how it was so difficult, because the judges said that, why are you here? You are wasting your time. And then they said that you don't have any locus standi. So we were fighting on these issues at that stage. Now nobody talks about the locus standi. Nobody talks about your fundamental duty. Nobody talks about the rights, because it is established now that yes, this has become our inherent right to go into the in the court, but with clean hands, not with dirty hands. With clean hands means that you should be honest, you should be clear, and your case should be very transparent. It is like a screen. When you go for an X-ray, the judges, they should see and guess that, yes, this is a case. And that is how in the Supreme Court happens. Number of times you face so many difficulties. So here, why I am narrating all this? I'm narrating that Justice Bhagwati was a very kind judge, in the sense that if a junior used to stand in the court, he used to at least, you know, give a time, maybe few seconds, a minute, 2 minutes, whatever, but he used to encourage. And if you know that the Bhopal tragedy took place on the fourth December 1984. And the same, it was a very, the first anniversary was on 4th December 1985. I had filed a case against Shriram Food and Fertilizers Limited, which you maybe might have read, SFFI, Shriram Food and Fertilizers. I thought that, yes, there may be a time when the gas may leak from this industry, from this factory. This is a DCM, Delhi Cloth Mills. It was a big business house. And they were operating from Delhi itself. The industry was there. So I filed a case. When I filed a case, and I went to the registrar of the Supreme Court by saying that, please list this case for early hearing. And the registrar of the Supreme Court looks at my face and he said, gentlemen, why are you here? I said that I want that this case should be listed. He said, no, it is not important at all. It will come in its own way. So again, I said that it is very important. Please look into that. He said, no. You go, why don't you practice? Why don't you do? Why don't you think on other issues? So I came back frustrated. I kept that one file of this Shriram Food and Fertilizer case in my locker in the Supreme Court. And I forgot. I said, let it come on its own way. On 4th December, I had another case from polluting industries from Mumbai and Thane and all those areas in Gujarat and Bombay. At that time, it was not Mumbai, it was Bombay. So anyway, I had filed that case. That case came on, incidentally, on 4th December 1985. That was listed, and three judges were sitting: Justice Madden, Justice Oza, and Chief Justice of India, Justice Bhagwati. And The Oza was from Mumbai, and he said, "You have drafted this beautiful petition. We don't know that we are sitting on the time bomb, and it is ticking." So I just, you know, I looked at them. I did not say anything. I just thanked them, and then just Bhagwati issued notice. That is the first. Otherwise, your case is gone. He issued notice in this case. But by that time, the same day, the gas had leaked in Delhi from the same industry against whom I went to the registrar for the listing the case. So I just went to police station to, and then to inquired from the press and all that, that from where the gas has leaked, because all in the Supreme Court, all we lawyers were running here, there, and I said, what has happened? Gas koi leak hui hai, gas leak hui hai. And in the meantime, I went to the Times of India to find out. It is very near to our the Supreme Court. I walked. I tried to find out that from where the gas has leaked. I was certain that the gas has leaked from the same industry and against whom my case is pending. So once this happened, I went to Times of India, the Indian Express, the everybody said, no, you go back. There's a huge cloud is coming towards that side. And if you remember that, if you read, that a lawyer in T. Cesari court, he also died. And then three other people, they died. And many other got injuries, and so many things happened. I ran back, and by that time, this Bombay case was listed. And I said, my lords, I have to say something. And Justice Madden thought that I am asking to immediately close down all those industries in that very particular, the first case. And he was not allowing me. You want that all the industries should be closed down? I said, no, I don't want that. But kindly listen to me. And the other judge, again, he said the same thing. And then I said, but I have to say something else. I don't want, your lordships have issued notice in the first case. I am not talking about that. I am trying to say something else. Then Justice Bhagwati, he looked at me, he said, what do you want to say? Tell me. He used to give time to juniors. And then I said, my lord, the gas has leaked in Delhi, and I am worried about your lordship's life. And all that people, they're sitting in the courtroom, all the lawyers, they got up and they said, yes. Gas has leaked in Delhi, and we are all running here, there. We don't know what has happened to our families and what has happened to our children, and what's all. And Justice Bhagwati looked at me, so, but what is done? I said, my lord, my petition is here. I gave that petition, handed over, and then they said that immediately issued notice on 4th December, and immediately they're returnable on 6th December 1986. And the next day, on 4th it was listed, ordered, and then on 6th December 1985, it was returnable notice, dusty notice to everybody. By that time, the Parliament of India, at that time it was sitting. And the whole daily papers were full because it was the first anniversary of the Bhopal, anniversary of the gas leak. And then this case shot up, you know, and it just, you know, that created a panic in the whole, almost a whole country, that how many potential, we are sitting on the potential bombs in India. And that is even today. It is not that we are very safe, in very safe zones. No. The situation has improved a little bit, but not as we say that, yes, now we are in heaven. It is not. The situation is worsening every day. So this is how the things happen. Why I'm saying Justice Bhagwati, because he was a very kind judge. And after that, on the 6th again, when the case came, and he looked at me, and he said, what has to be done? On 6th again, the gas leaked from the same plant. I sent those papers immediately in his chamber, and then on 7th he listed again, and he said, "What is happening?" And then that case was heard, and this is the, I think that if you have the research, you know, if you do research, you will see that in the shortest possible time, the Supreme Court of India delivered judgment in this case. And in less than 1 year, on 20th December 1986, Justice Bhagwati retired, and on 4th December 1985, he issued notice. Then so many hearings and so many things happened. After commission, after sending experts and so many, and then these industries were closed down, and then later on they had to pay compensation, they had to sue, and then here the Supreme Court said the principles were laid down, and then it is not only the precautionary principle, the strict and absolute liability principle came into existence, and so many other things happened. So strict and absolute liability principle that came after 120 years, Rayland versus Fletcher. After that, in 1986, the Supreme Court of India said that we can't keep our eyes closed now. We have to look for the new frontiers. And this is the time that Justice Bhagwati said that now the strict and absolute liability principle is the law of the land. So how these things happen, you know, one by one. In the meantime, Justice Bhagwati was hearing my other cases also, but in those cases also, but they were like a child labor case, the child labor case, and the entire country's child labor case, I took that. Because in Shivakasi and the firecracking industries and all those things were happening, and there the children, they were huddled into the buses in the early morning and then taken to the factories, and then they were given a pittance of say 4 rupees or 5 rupees, and then they were like a slave, the children were slave in those industries, you know. And they were, so I filed that case, he issued notice in that. Then later on, so many things happened, but then because he retired, so other judges, they gave the judgments in those cases. After his retirement, Justice Bhagwati was also all the time a thinker and a practical person in the sense that he never felt that, yes, I have retired. He one day, because I never meet judges when they are in serving judges, it is my principle. I don't, yes, in the public meeting or somewhere, yes, we can, but I don't do that. But here, after his retirement, I met him and I thanked him, and he said, tell me what has to be done now. And then idea came that I said that the court has done, but a lot of things have to be done. So for that, what? He said, I think that we should set up this organization which should be able to reach the masses and tell the on environmental issues and save the environment of this country. So I said, what should be the name? So the name was Indian Council for Enviro Legal Action. You might be reading that. That is also our organization. So the Indian Council for Enviro Legal Action, that was where the Justice Bhagwati was the president of this organization. He accepted. And then I was the general secretary of that. And Dr. G.D. Agarwal, he was the founder member of that. So this is how I'm linking, and Dr. G.D. Agarwal, as Raji has said, it is really sad. Dr. G.D. Agarwal was a scientist who stood by me. He was a first member secretary of the Central Pollution Control Board. He did his PhD in 1960s from California. And he was the dean of IIT Kanpur. He was a distinguished scientist of this country. So he left everything, and he said, now what has to be done? I said that. So he became a monk. He left everything. He was a rich, very rich person, but he left, and he tried to evolve, you know. And just Bhagwati told me, Mr. Mehta, why don't you file one case on behalf of Isla, that we call the Indian Conservative, Isla is a short name. So Isla. I said, sir, what? He said, no. Dekho, wahan pe jo, in Andhra Pradesh, mein problems hain because the shrimp farming, S. Jagannathan versus Union of India and others, if you might have read. So this S. Jagannathan versus Union of India and others, he was referred by Justice Bhagwati to me. He said, Mr. Mehta, I am sending one person to you, and please see that this case can be filed in the court. Now this Jagannathan, S. Jagannathan, I never realized that he was half blind, and then he came with a stick in his hand, and he came to my office with one person, Prem Bhai. He was another social activist. So he came and he sat with me and he said, do this case. I said, what is this case? That this is shrimp farming, shrimp culture, and it is destroying. The people are becoming homeless. All those things are happening. And I want. And I heard him, and after that I politely said, this Jagannathan ji, I'm sorry. This case is not fit for filing in the Supreme Court. And I don't know what happened. He jumped. He said, what, for this we have achieved, we got independence? Let the India be again like a slave country. I fought the freedom movement. And then I asked him, who is this man? So all this I came to know. And then it was really, I said, there is no case still. And this Prem Bhai, he Barmasi Seva Ashram from this Uttar Pradesh, he was also, he said, please, if it is possible. Now, I said, now, Justice Bhagwati, he has told me to file this case. Let me see, and this person, you know, is a freedom fighter. I went to Tamil Nadu, and in Madurai, and there you will not believe that how the things can happen. I went there and he was sitting in a small thatched hut, and I traveled. At that time there was no flights to Madurai and all those places. From Chennai I went there and by road, and then I said, where is Jagannathan ji? One person went in and he said, Jagannathan ji, he is here. I said, okay. I said, I want to see. He has asked me to show the things. And then it was the, he said very casually that, and a small, you know, that's like a cot came out, and there I sat. I was with the scientist, Professor T. Shivaji Rao. He is no more also. And then that T. Shivaji Rao, G. T. Agarwal, Justice Bhagwati, why I am saying all these things? They were stalwarts in this country. As a scientist, Dr. T. Shivaji Rao and Dr. G. D. Agarwal. And here, Justice Bhagwati as a luminary and a stalwart in judicial. And he could see the nerve of the people, and he could see that how the things should be improved in this country. It was a visionary approach that he could see things, you know, much ahead. That yes, something has to be done. There's a vacuum, and this vacuum has to be filled by creating, evolving new policies, new laws, new things. That is what is the role of a judge, a scientist, and a lawyer. Judiciary cannot function in a personal litigation you can go and the two cases are one and two against each other in the property matters or in other cases. But here that you have to think about millions of people, the life in the future, and all those things you have to be concerned. So for that, in any case, when I went over there and I saw this, the shrimp case which was referred by Justice Bhagwati to me, it was an eye-opening thing that when I sat there and in a minute, somebody was coming from there, somebody was coming there, and in a few minutes, there were about 15 to 2,000 people. What they did, that somebody climbed on a tree and he just a bugle, you know, the like a shank, jisko bolte hain, that he blew that shank, and with that, the people, they came, and the half naked men and women, you know, they just started sitting before me on the sandy soil. And they said, and then she said that these people, the shrimp farming industry, they came to me in the morning, and they wanted to bribe me. I said, you kill me, but I don't want bribe. This is a person that who wants to save the soul. We have to save the soul of the people, those who can't do something for us. But we have to do. We have to save their soul, because if we have that capacity to do that, if we have thinking, and if we are really, you know, that we believe in some values, then in that situation, we should be able to whatever, because you will be the future lawyers, you will be the future scientists, you will be this future of this country in one way or this. Some people will become industrialists, somebody will something. So you have a long things to do in this world. So if you have to do long things, then for that, you see that you have to spare some time for those who can't think that, and who have nothing to accept their soul is there, and their body is there, and they live in a way, but those people, they have iron wills. So the same lady, she said that they came, and then ultimately in the they left that. I said, what happened? Then Professor Shivajira was there. And then he said, no, Mehta, you have to do. He got emotional. He said, I said, you are a scientist, you tell me. And then I said, again, I am not convinced. This is not a case unless I get convinced. I said, let me see the shrimp farms itself. So then I went there. Professor Shivaji Rao was there with me, and I was there. And then they took me from one farm to the other. I was still not convinced. And then when I came back, I saw that at that time, Jayalalitha was the chief minister. And the other lady who was her associate, Sasikala. And they told me that this farm is Jayalalitha's. This is Sasikala's farm. This is that farm. And then I was surprised. I saw the police, and that police, you know, they were surrounding that farm, which was Sasikala's farm, shrimp farm. There, the police was, and the superintendent of police, they were dragging the people. There was a hugging the earth. The poor people, they hugged the earth peacefully, and Jagannathan was stood behind that. And this, the Prem Bhai and all those people, they were there. And then they were pushing back, and they were again. Then I said, I want to. No, sir, we don't want that. Since you have to file this case, you will also be arrested over here. Then I said that, please don't worry. I came out from the car, and then I started seeing all this, the whole thing. After a few minutes, I left that. I said, but my peace, whatever I have, I was peaceful, I lost my peace. I became restless to make that case. And I did that. And then after that, this, you know that whole India, not only India, the all Asian countries and all that, they got benefited from this S. Jagannathan versus Union of India. So why I'm saying all this? Justice Bhagwati was a great judge, and he pioneered, he helped the system. After his retirement, he remained active everywhere. Wherever, you know, one Green March on behalf of Islam, I have traveled about more than 3,000 kilometers during, whenever I get time, I organize this and I walk about 100 kilometers sometimes, 200 kilometers this way. And I asked Justice Bhagwati, sir, I'm going to Jammu, and that is my home state, and I will Green March. He said, that's good, I am going to come. Justice Bhagwati and and his wife both came there. And in 3-4 days, I could organize the meeting. And the meeting, you will be surprised, when we started walking, more than 10,000 people were with us. And they were surprised. Justice Bhagwati said, what to do now? And we were talking. I said, sir, now, because we thought that only 25 people will walk with us, and we will go up to Srinagar. But now there were, what to do? Then I asked people to stand on the bus. There was a bus, and he went up, and from there he said, I said that you please somehow disperse this crowd. We can't control. And I immediately I said to Justice Bhagwati and his wife, I said, you please, you sit in the car, and you just go to the hotel, and we will manage it. And then after that, he did that. I dispersed the crowd. I said, we are stopping. We don't want to go. What to do? And then we made a list of 30 people, and then we went. All that was a terrorist infested area, all Kashmir, Srinagar, the whole we traveled. And the things changed. So the point is that why such great men? Why such only a few people are called as great? Because they have the spirit, because they have the kindness, because they are not greedy. They have a sacrificing spirit. And they are the people, those who become the beacon light for the others. And those who can sacrifice. This sacrifice is not done. You see that in ivory towers, you can't, sitting there, you can't make a change. A few judges, a few citizens, whether it was Mahatma Gandhi or it was Subhash Chandra Bose or so many others. If you read their history, then you will realize that, yes, how great sacrifice they did. And today we are enjoying that fruit. So my friends, what I'm trying to say that the third incident, what happened, was the, in 1991, Justice Bhagwati and we sat. Manika Gandhi was the minister at that time for environment. And she called me and she said, MC, I need your help. I said, madam, what do you want? He said, no, environment course ki baat. Because we said the environment course should be set up. This was Justice Bhagwati's one of the recommendation. So I said that, do that. She said, no. Is it possible for you to make a bill? I said that if your government is willing to do, I will try to do. We sat, Justice Bhagwati, myself, and then after that we drafted the whole bill. And after drafting the bill, we went. We organized a big meeting of legal luminaries, and we discussed clause by clause. And then we gave that to Manika Gandhi. And then at that time, I said that now, will this be dumped in your files, or this will see the light of the day? She said, I will try. I don't accuse her that she was a bad. She put a joint secretary from the Ministry of Environment to that every day that Mr. Mehta is busy, you please go to his office every day and just find out. She, and he was coming, the joint secretary from his her ministry, he used to come and ask me that, okay, what has been done and what has not been done. I said, I am doing it, but please don't worry. But then we organized the law ministry, and then they came into picture. All those things, it took time. And nothing happened. You please, in 1991, if the environment course would have been set up at that time, you know that the today that situation would not have been there. It is, the situation is worsening today. So my friends, there's a need for, one is if you are the citizen of this country, the fundamental duties, you know. The court, the Supreme Court, in one of my judgment, I read that Article 51AG of the Constitution of India, and where I said it shall be the duty of every citizen of India to protect environment, rivers, lakes, and have compassion for animal life. This is one duty. I read that, and I thought over that. I made that in a petition of 25 pages. And then I went, and the judges looked at me, how can it be possible? How is this possible? All those things. I said, my lords, it is possible. And then I convinced them, and then they were kind. They said, we issue notice. And after that, the environment, this Supreme Court, a historic judgment was given, where, you know, in other countries, now the environment has been made compulsory. But here in India, even the universities, so many professors, vice chancellors, they told me, sir, ye itna achha nahi hai. It is not so good. You know, I said, what? You don't need air to breathe? You need you don't need water to drink? What are you talking? So this is the level of thinking of our academy also. This is a very sad part. That I said, you breathe or no? If you don't breathe, then it's fine. Then they keep quiet. So this is the thing that we should see, that yes, what we are eating, what we are thinking, what we are breathing, we should know. Here I did many years back, this Sonipat, Panipat, Karnal, all those, we walked from this area. And I never thought, you know, that this is, you are sitting on a potential threat of environmental doom. It is here. The groundwater has gone up to 400 to 500 feet below. What are you talking about? The water which you are drinking, it is a poison which you are drinking. You don't know what type of water, what heavy elements, what the toxic elements are there in this water. I talked to those people. I went from village to village, from there, from Delhi, we went up to Kurukshetra. And then from Kurukshetra, we walked up to this Shimla, and then beyond all those we walked. And we came to realize that, yes, this is so sad that the beautiful places, now there, you know, nothing is there, you know, to drink. You don't have safe water to drink. You don't have the food, the chemicals, all what you are taking here, it is a poison. I'm not discouraging you, you eat, but you please see, you ask your the system, you know, here or anywhere, to your parents, that from where you have bought this vegetables, from where you have bought these fruits, from where you have bought these things. And it is nothing, it is all toxics. So now why, was there any need to go for this doomed day? There was no need. The whole country was organic country. Whole country, India. Wherever you could go, they were saying that the flowing water in a stream or a river, that is pure. It is a belief. Now, you go and Gangaji's water is not. That's why Dr. G.D. Agarwal, can you see that 110 days he was there on fast, only taking water. And on 110th day, he said, no, I am not going to take water hereafter. And what the system has done, the first when he said, he was immediately taken by the police, arrested, and to the hospital in Dune, in Dehradun. that it was taken over there. Then a writ petition was filed in the Nainital High Court. And then Nainital High Court, the judges were good, and they gave a very good order. They said that you please, you know, take him to Ames at Rishikesh, and you do this, that it can be, and take all the precautions and this and that. He was there. Then he was saved. But then after that, again he was allowed to go to Haridwar, and he sat over there. But on 110th day, he left that water, and then the police came, and all those things, and then he was again taken to the hospital, and he died over there. So this is what, you know, that somebody, Dr. G.D. Agarwal did not know you, but he was speaking for you. That is what your spirit should be, that you are citizen of this country. If you are thinking, you should not think only for yourself, but you should think for others also. Those who are known or unknown or who far-flung areas, those who can't afford, who are voiceless, you have to become voice for the voiceless. That should be your spirit. So this is the thing, and Justice Bhagwati became the voice for the voiceless and gave a judicial, various judicial pronouncements, and with that, it was a relief to so many millions of people, and similarly so many other people. So my friends, it is your time now. It is not that over that we have to remind you every time. You must think. I give 1 hour at least in his memory, or in Dr. G.D. Agarwal, or T. Shivaji Rao, or so many others, those who have died. That there in Haridwar, one Swamiji was saying that when he is sitting in ashram, he is fine. But as soon as he is taken to the hospital, he is killed over there. And that is what, because one Swami earlier died the same way. He was again, you know, he died over there because for this protection of the Gangaji and all that. Now the Ganga water is not safe. You go from far off, from all over the world, the people, they go. The water in many stretches of the Ganga, it is unfit for washing, bathing, drinking, or educational purposes. So this is the state of affairs. Similarly, the groundwater, so many, 600 dark spots are there in the country, and so many others. So I don't want to give you more picture of what is happening in this country, but you as a student, you please see that you must at least give 1 hour, 1 hour a day, or one half a day in a week or whatever, you know. Make the environment. Go here, there. Or if you don't, I can come sometime and walk with you. And I will show you that what can you do. You can make a difference. When you go back, you will say that, yes, in five areas, in five, we could do this thing. The people, they shifted to organic farming. In one village, if you make an example around that, this I will request our vice chancellor here that please, all around your campus, you please persuade farmers that they should go and you should buy their product over for here. That will be, you know, a wonderful thing. Because that is what they want. The organic vegetables, organic food is more costlier. So they have a belief that, no, put pesticides. And by that, you know, they will immediately, you know, reap the fruits. They will bring the vegetables and all that, and fruits and this and that. And it is all poison, please believe me. And so if you make a circular around this, and I will come if you want, 2-3 days, I can come all. And I have walked already, and the people are very cooperative. They only want something, there's some help. And we can persuade, I can ask experts, those who are in organic farming, they can come and they can see that, yes, around you, because if you are encircled with pollutants, you are unsafe over here. You will not be able to breathe. But if you make a circle around you, then you will be saved and the others will also be saved. So please do that. So I don't want to take your time. If you have any questions, you can ask me. But I pray that wherever this Bhagavati's soul is, we pray that his soul may be really, you know, he will be at is at peace, and we should remember him, not only for a day today, but for our life long period, and memories should be there, and whatever you can contribute, because I dealt with him, so I am more attached with him. But since if you are, you deal with a person and you see his behavior, you feel, yes, he was a wonderful, he was a giant of a judge, and he was a person who could see, foresee the things, you know, and he took steps at that time when no other judges even thought of. Thank you very much.